At home, the Lord has so much more in store for us. Amen. Gospel of Luke. The Gospel of Luke, chapter number 21, but hold your places there and turn with me to Matthew chapter 5. Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Father, we stretch our hands to thee. No other help we know. You are the source, because you are the creator. In you we live and move and have our being. And without you, we can do nothing. So, Lord, we lift our eyes to the hills. And we acknowledge that all of our help comes from you. Help us, Lord. Help us, Lord. Help us, Lord. Help us, Lord. Teach us your way. Not our will, but your will be done. God be glorified in your people. Your kingdom, for your great name's sake. We just thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We thank you for keeping us from day to day, keeping us with a mind to serve you, a mind to give you the glory and the honor. Bless now your word, Lord, that you've already sent forth to prosper in the hearts of those that will believe. In Jesus' name, we pray and give thanks for all things. Amen and amen. Thank you, Lord. When you see these things, when you see these things, the Bible is filled with blessings. Jesus himself pronounced blessings upon his disciples. Blessings on those who would read his word. Blessings on those who would hear his word. And certainly blessings upon those who would believe and obey his word. Matthew chapter 5, you are familiar with these blessings that Jesus pronounced. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn. They shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek. They shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. They shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful. They shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart. For they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers. They shall be called the sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake. Theirs is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you when men will what? Revile you and persecute you, Jesus says, and say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. You're still blessed. You're still blessed. You're still blessed. He said, rejoice in what? Be exceedingly glad. Not just glad, exceedingly glad. For great is your reward in heaven, for so they persecuted the prophets that came before you. Now, all of these are absolutely wonderful blessings. Wonderful. In which the disciples of Jesus can take, and that's us, we can take great comfort in all of these. However, I believe that there is a blessing that many of us may take for granted. And I will dare say it is indisputably one of the most important and perhaps the most indispensable of all of the blessings that Jesus himself pronounced. So if you again in your Bibles turn to Matthew 13, just a few pages over, beginning at verse number 15, these words are written, Jesus speaking concerning those who are in the darkness. Matthew 13, verse 15, for the hearts of this people have grown dull. Their ears, hard of hearing. Their eyes, they have closed, lest they should see with their eyes, hear with their ears, lest they should understand in their hearts and turn so that I should heal them. But listen what he says. Look at this blessing. Blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, for they hear. For assuredly, Jesus says, I say to you that many prophets and righteous men desired to see what you see and did not see it, to hear what you hear and did not hear it. Blessed are your eyes, for they see. Seeing, hearing, and understanding, invaluable. I would dare say, I believe this, y'all, if I would ask y'all what's the most popular song, the most widely known song, perhaps in the history, but certainly over the last 50, 60, 70 years, that everybody knows, what would you say? I know you wouldn't get it. Most of you probably wouldn't get it because you don't think about it. The song was written more than 200 years ago. It is the national anthem of the United States. Y'all know the song. It's real short. It was basically, it came from a poem written by Francis Scott Key when he was looking out and he saw the war that was taking place. And he saw the Star-Spangled Banner in the midst of the war, still yet flying, which gave him hope. So he penned these words of the Star-Spangled Banner to a poem. But the song really begins with a question. We don't think of it as a question. Oh, say, can you see? Can you see? Can you see the times in which we live? Can you see? We are trekking more rapidly to the end of time, time as we now know it, to the end of this world and this world system as we now know it. It has been prophesied. It's promised in the Holy Scriptures. And it is absolutely certain. It's going to happen. But before the end comes, the word of the Lord warns the reader, the hearer, that there will be certain events that will indicate that the end is near. And as we draw ever closer to the end of time, to the end of this present world as we know it to be, the Bible tells us we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things that we have also what? Heard, lest we should let them slip. But It is these words of the Lord Jesus, back to Luke chapter 21, that I am certain was in the mind of the writer of Hebrews. Jesus, in verse number 34, said this to the disciples, which certainly applies to all of us as well. He said, take heed to yourselves, lest your hearts be weighed down with carousing, drunkenness, and cares of this life, and that day come on you unexpectedly. For it will come as a snare on all those who dwell on the face of the whole earth. Watch therefore, Jesus says, and pray always that you may be counted worthy. And Peter picked it up and said, if the righteous scarcely are saved. That you may be counted worthy to escape all these things that will come to pass, and to stand before the Son of Man. Now, some who think they know may have studied history, world history, and they've certainly studied it from a secular perspective, from a humanistic outlook. They have erroneously concluded that life is arbitrary, that history is cyclical, things just go around in circles. However, the Word of God points explicitly, exclusively, in a linear trajectory straight to what Jesus, the prophets, the Bible clearly tells us is going to happen, that there is an end to this world and this world system. And it's going to be violently overthrown. Now, for the humanists, this is frightening. For the carnal-minded, worldly man, this is unthinkable, unbearable. For the fool, the agnostic, the professed atheist, this is unbelievable. They don't believe it. For those who have simply ignored the Word of God, the wisdom of God, and the counsel of God, it will be devastating. Because all of their hopes, all of their dreams, all of their treasures, all of their future is tied up in this world, in this world system. This is the only hope that they have. It's the only life that they know. It's the only life they expect to know. All of their marbles, all of their eggs, if you will, are in this one basket. It's a house that's built on sinking sand. It's the only life that they know, and this is all that matters to them. And with each succeeding generation, it seems as though we are sinking further and further into the depths of depravity and despondency. And if we would only look to the Word of God, to the wisdom of God, we would not be confounded. We would not be in despair. We would not be without hope. And we would clearly see what is transpiring, what is being fulfilled right before our eyes. Being in the ark of safety has benefits. You can't drink up all that water. You can't swim that long and that hard. Abiding under the shadow of the wings of the Almighty provides covering. Living in the secret place affords us protection. Looking to Jesus gives us insight. The insight we need to see these things come into pass again right before our very eyes. See it, and yet, as Jesus said, not be shaken, not be terrified, not be fearful, and certainly not to be in unbelief or disbelief. Our key verse today is verse 31, in which Luke records these words of Jesus, that when you see these things, when you see these things, know that the kingdom of God is near. When you see these things, I guess the question again is, oh, say, can you see? My God, because there are people that are certainly blind. The world is blinded. The Bible says they are blinded. And Satan, the Bible says, has blinded them. Satan has blinded their eyes. So they don't see it. Everything that's happening, they see it, but they don't see it. They hear, but they don't hear. They don't perceive. Jesus, Luke 21, verse number 8, says these words, take heed, another warning, that you not be deceived. Don't let anyone fool you. Don't let anyone trick you. Don't let anyone tell you this is going on forever and ever and ever. Don't let anyone fool you into believing Jesus is not coming back. He's coming back one day. I don't know when. I just know he's coming back. Somebody's going to be getting married. Ooh. Somebody's going to be on vacation. Oh, yeah. Somebody's going to be at work. Somebody's going to be retired at home watching television. But he's coming. Take heed that you be not deceived. Jesus said, for many will come in my name. They're going to say, I am he. The time has drawn near. Jesus said, therefore, do not go after them. Don't believe them. When you hear of wars and commotions, do not be terrified. Do not be fearful. Do not be afraid. For these things, Jesus said, must come to pass first. But the end will not come immediately. Then he said, listen what Jesus said. Nation will rise up against nation. Kingdom against kingdom. This is happening. It's always been. Man can't live in peace. That's what he said. Fences make good neighbors. It's true. If you don't have any fences, your neighbor going to blow all his leaves over there while you at work. If you got a fence, it's hard for him to blow all his leaves over on your property while you at work. You get home, you say, wait a minute, didn't I just do my yard the other day? Where all these leaves come from? Nation against nation, kingdom against kingdom, neighbor against neighbor. Jesus said all this stuff is going to happen. There will be great earthquakes, he says, in various places. We've had more earthquakes in the last century than we had in all of human history. There will be famines, pestilences. There will be fearful signs or sights, Jesus says, and great signs from heaven. But before all these things, Jesus says, listen what's going to happen. He tells, this is directly to the disciples. He says, they're going to lay their hands on you. Peter, James, John, all of you, Paul and Silas, Paul wasn't there at the time, but all of these apostles, particularly many of the early church and disciples, were persecuted far more than we ever probably see in our days. They will lay their hands on you, persecute you, delivering you up to the synagogues and prisons. You will be brought before kings and rulers for my name's sake. Jesus warned them this was going to happen. But it will turn out for you as an occasion for testimony. Jesus said, therefore, settle it in your heart not to meditate beforehand on what you will answer, because in that moment, I'm going to give you a mouth. I'm going to give you the wisdom which all your adversaries will not be able to contradict or resist. And you can see that with Stephen in Acts chapter 7. After he finished and he called them out for who they were, he said, you stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, you do always resist the Holy Ghost. And boy, when Stephen got finished, they couldn't say a word. They just got mad. They got hot. They stopped their ears, the Bible said, and just ran on him. That's what Jesus said. You will be betrayed even by parents and brothers, relatives and friends, and they will put some of you to death. They did it. Almost all of the apostles were martyred. You will be hated by all for my name's sake. Yes. Not a hair of your head shall be lost. By your patience, Jesus says, possess your souls. Now then, listen what he says. But when you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies, then know that its desolation is near. Now, much of biblical prophecy, a lot of biblical prophecy has double fulfillment. Part of this fulfillment happened in AD 70, but it is not the final, because we're going to see in the Revelation, as Jesus prophesies, the Bible tells us, when these nations will come against Jerusalem one final time, the battle of Armageddon, that's yet to come. But the partial fulfillment of this happened in AD 70 when the Roman army came and surrounded Jerusalem. Jesus said, let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Yes. Let those who are in the midst of her depart. Let not those who are in the country enter her. For these are the days of vengeance. Yes. And you know why? You know why this happened, by the way? Because they chose Barabbas over Jesus. And they said, his blood be on us and our children. And 37 years later, that blood came back on them and their children. Jesus said, oh, Jerusalem, oh, if only you had known. If only you could see, have seen. All these things, he says, which are written may be fulfilled, but woe to those who are pregnant, to those who are nursing babies in those days, for there will be great distress in the land and wrath upon this people, his own people. They will fall by the edge of the sword. All of this happened, AD 70. Be led away captive unto all nations, and Jerusalem, listen what Jesus said, will be trampled by Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles are fulfilled. It's almost over, y'all. That's why Jerusalem, you hear so much, and there is so much, and they occupy. You have Jews and Gentiles there. The Jews have begun, and certainly this happened several decades ago, returning to Israel, as the Bible prophesied. See, when you see these things, Jesus said, furthermore, there will be signs in the sun, in the moon, in the stars, and on the earth, distress of nations with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring, men's hearts failing them for fear and the expectation of those things that are coming on the earth, for the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Now, listen, Jesus says, when these things begin to happen, look up, lift up your heads, because your redemption draws near. So he spoke to them a parable. Look at the fig tree. You recognize this. Look at all the trees. You see them when they bud. You see and you know for yourselves that summer is now near. So you also, when you see these things, when you see these things that are happening, that the Bible tells us and spells out for us clearly what will happen. When you see these things happening, know that the kingdom of God is near. Paul picked it up in 2 Timothy chapter 3, for men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money. When you see these things, boasters, proud. Proud. Blasphemers. Disobedient to parents. Oh, help. Unthankful. Unholy. Unloving. Unforgiving. Slanderers. Without self-control. Brutal. Despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but denying the power. Jesus said, from such turn away. Can you see it? Is it not happening? Is it not happening? I was talking to an elder earlier this week, and he said, I have not seen so much evil in all my days. So I guess I'm not the only one, and I'm not even watching the news. Can you see what's happening? Jesus said, when you see these things, when you see the days of Noah, he said, because as it was in the days of Noah, when you see it, they're building, they're planting, they're marrying and giving in marriage, the earth filled with violence. When you see these things, when you see the days of Lot, you already know what was happening in Sodom and Gomorrah. It wasn't just the homosexuality and the lesbianism, but the Bible says this was the sin of Sodom, pride and fullness of bread. When you see it. When you see them filled with their pride and arrogancy, blaspheming. When you see them departing from the faith, this is what the Bible says. Many will depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of it. When you see it, when you see them falling away, he says, when you see them speaking lies in hypocrisy, false prophets rising up, when you see them turning their ears away from the truth, when you see them turn to fables, when you see them invent, the Bible says, invent evil things. When you see them always learning, but never coming to the knowledge of it. When you see these things, can you see? When you see all of the wars and rumors of wars, earthquakes, perplexity of nations, Jesus said, fear gripping the hearts of men. Oh, I've never seen so much fear just taking control. When you see the spirit of fear that's tormenting. And fear is torment. People are, do you realize how many people are being tormented by fear now? Do you realize the suicide rate that's happening now? Among so many young people. They're just taking their lives. 20 years old, 15 years old. Young people just going up, jumping off of a building, laying in front of railroad trains. Fear. Hopelessness, despair, despondency. Jesus said, when you see these things, men's hearts failing them for fear. They're afraid of the future, afraid of tomorrow, afraid of the problems that they're facing. Afraid there's no solution, afraid there's no hope. Because fear comes in, and that's why the Bible said God has fear, but a power, love, and a what kind of mind? Sound mind. Oh, say, can you see? When you see these things, when you see them, Jesus said, know that the kingdom of God is near. Know that your redemption is even closer. Paul wrote in Romans, I believe, it's nearer than when we first believe. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Know that every eye shall see him, every eye, the Bible says, every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess. Yes, sir. Know that the King of Kings is soon to come. Oh, yes. He's going to put down every enemy of rebellion. He will rule and he will reign in righteousness forever. And he says to us, when you see these things, when you see, can you see them? Can you see them? When you see these things happening, he says, no. And then he said, look up. Don't look around. There's no help here. There's no help to be, I'm telling you now, there's no help to be found here. None. You better look up. He said, because your redemption draws nigh. When you see these things, when you see these things, know. There's something you have to know. There's something we have to know as the people of God. That's why Jesus did, again, pronounced that blessing upon his disciples. Blessed are your eyes because they see. The world sees it, but they don't see it. They don't see it. They just think, oh, we'll get through this. Oh, we'll get through. Oh, these things have happened. Oh, yes. But at some point, guess what? The Bible says it's going to be over. So Jesus said, do not be deceived. Do not be deceived. When you see these things, when you see these things, when you see these things, know. Just know it. That the kingdom of God is near. This is what the hope of the believer is. Is your hope for a better tomorrow? Is your hope just for gas to get back to $2.50 a gallon? That's $1.50. That's a great hope there. Is that your hope? Well, I'm just hoping that things will get better. What things? What things are going to get better? Yeah, what things are going to get better? My Frosted Flakes is going to go down to $1.99. What things? What things are going to get better? It may happen temporarily. But what things are going to get better? Jesus told us that evil men and seducers are going to get worse and worse. Deceiving and being deceived. So when you see these things, when you see it, can you see? It's happening. And listen, Jesus said, don't be terrified. Don't be afraid. Don't live in fear. Don't be perplexed. And don't even worry about tomorrow. He said, because all of these things the Gentiles see. Don't worry. I got you. Not a sparrow falls to the ground. Every hair on your head is numbered. Amen. Listen, never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. My hope is not in man. My hope is not in these institutions. I see these things happening. I see it happening. And Jesus said, blessed are your eyes, for they see, your ears, for they hear. Everybody don't see it. They don't hear it. Amen. Jesus said about his own people, when they came to him, or rather when he came to them, he said, these people, and Isaiah had already prophesied this, so Jesus was talking about what was already been prophesied. These people, their ears are dull of hearing. Their eyes, they have closed. They don't believe all the signs and the wonders, and they still don't believe. Jesus performed miracle after. See, miracles and signs and wonders don't save people. Not when the heart is dull, the ears are closed, the eyes are closed. They don't, and it's right there for them to see. But they don't see it. But Jesus said, blessed are your eyes, for they see. Man, is that not the blessing above blessings? You can see these things, and you know what's happening, and you know what is to come. And your hope, therefore, is not in these things, and you are not going to be deceived. Amen, because you can see it. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I'm so glad I can see. I'm glad I can see. I see these, and then again, seeing all of what's happening, not shaking. You got to have that heart like Esther had. Y'all know Esther? Esther, you know what Esther said? If I perish, I'm not worried. My life is in his hands. My life is in his hands. And my hope is in him. My hope is built on nothing less. Jesus Christ and his righteousness. I dare not trust. Oh, no, no, no. Don't trust in man. Amen. You better lean on Jesus. You better look to Jesus. And when you see these things, Father, help us. Help us. There's a liar on the loose. There's a thief. There's a destroyer. He and all of his demons. But Lord, you have given us power. You've given us the authority. And you've blessed us with spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. And you also blessed our eyes to see, our ears to hear, our hearts to understand, and to obey and to perceive all of these things that are coming to pass. All of these things that your word said would come to pass. So now, Lord, we just want to rest in you and rest patiently. Wait patiently for our strength to be renewed. Lord, we're not leaning to our own understanding. We're not looking to any other, but our hope is in you. Our trust is in you. Our confidence is in you. Because you have our peace. You have our joy. You are the source. You have the ability. Lord, you have the power. You have the authority. And you have already spoken. And what you have decreed shall come to pass. And we are seeing it right before our eyes. But you have so much more in store for us. Many, many, many precious promises and blessings. So much so that the writer says, eye has not seen, ear has not heard, neither has it entered into the hearts of men, the things that God has prepared for them that love him. But Lord, we are now here occupying until you come. In the midst of a crooked and perverse nation, Lord, help our lights to shine in the darkness. Lord, we want to be the ambassadors, the living epistles known and read of men, the salt of the earth, the city set on the hill that cannot be hidden. Lord, help us to stand in this evil day and be a testimony that Jesus is alive, that Jesus saves, that Jesus redeems, that Jesus' blood still works. Help us, Lord. Help us, Lord. Help us, Lord. Be thou glorified. Be thou magnified. Be thou exalted, both now and forever. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Yeah.